Well, I think to know the truth would have been the biggest thing. I thought it was a glob of tissue. If I had known that this was an actual baby, if I had heard that heartbeat,
seeing the picture,
seeing that baby on that picture, I think that would have changed my mind.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
We met up with Al and Lisa Robertson in Atlanta, Georgia, on our whirlwind adventure tour to share 5 pro-life messages in 5 cities in just 5 days. It definitely was exhausting, but it was so fun and so worth it. Our audiences were riveted by the stories that were shared, and they were all so excited to stand with us for the dignity and value of all human life. Mm-hmm. And you likely know Al and Lisa Robertson from A&E's Duck Dynasty. That's the Robertson family. They've been here on our program a couple of times. And our last episode with Al and Lisa, we shared some of their family childhood stories, how they met and dated and struggled. It was tough stuff. Lisa openly talked about getting pregnant as a teen by another man and having an abortion.
And if you missed the first part of our conversation, click the link below to find that. And we're going to pick up now with the balance of Al and Lisa's remarkable story.
Al, let me come back to you. The partying in New Orleans, you hear about Lisa's situation. And this is a turning point, in my opinion, as I read your story, in desperate forgiveness. Right. Why did that impact you? A lot of guys would say, unfortunately, that's too bad. But that wasn't the only emotion you had.
No, whenever I sitting on that city street in Kenner outside New Orleans, the Lord and I had a serious discussion, and I was able to see my own life finally, clearly. And so God was telling me, a police officer who I don't know who he is, I can't wait to meet him in heaven. Thank you, police officers, for guiding
Amen.
Young people that need help. I appreciate all they do. Absolutely.
That's right. Because what did he do for you?
He told me, he said, he saw the vulnerability. And instead of just, heaping on like all the other people were doing around there and saying you're an idiot, all that was true, he said, you need to go home. And he meant to West Monroe, but he also meant home. Mm-hmm. And he prayed with me. And I'll never forget that. And I just, tears were flowing. And I just thought, what an opportunity. He saw an 18-year-old kid that was just at the end of the rope, and he said, he gave me a guidepost. And I took it. And when I got back home, Mom and Dad met me in the yard, and it was just like Luke 15 all over again. They extended grace. They didn't give me a speech. They didn't give me a lot. Dad said, we got duck calls to bill. And that night, that was his speech. And that night, we killed the fattened catfish because the lost son had come home, right? Just like Luke 15.
The fattened catfish. I love it.
And I at first decided, I thought, women are bad for me because it's me, not them. And so I was just going to try to go with, the Apostle Paul and Jesus and just walk it solo. So that lasted 2 months. And
that's an honest statement.
It wasn't my gift. And I thought about Lisa. It's just like she appeared in my mind. And I had heard about what had happened. I'd heard about her life. And I took a lot of that blame because I knew when I met her, she was a good girl. When I left her, not so good. And I knew I helped start her on that path. So the evil one had used me, and that made me really upset. And so I called her, and she was dating some guy, and he said he was going to marry her. She was about to graduate high school. So I said, well, you want to go out Friday? And she said, sure. And she dropped that guy like a hot rock, And
say that again. You're proud of that.
She dropped that guy like a hot rock. That's right. And so our first date was just this amazing. I went to her house and picked her up and did things properly. Her parents didn't think much of me, nor should they have. And that first night was just us talking about our lives. And she shared almost everything with me that first night. I don't know that you told me about the abuse, but she told me almost everything else, including the abortion. And it was just like we just bonded in brokenness. You know, and I had come to a realization a little quicker than her that Christ was the way out. And I told her that I had changed my life. I said, look, I would love to date you. I've quit drinking. I'm not doing drugs, and I don't want to have sex before I get married. And she was like, well, I'm on board with that. That sounds great. And so we began dating, and so it got real serious, real fast. My biology was trying to take over my theology, which happens a lot of times with young people. And so we made a decision that we wanted to get married and we wanted to begin a life together, and we did. And so I asked
from one weekend
from
to
one
the
weekend
next.
To the next, because I didn't believe in long engagements. Because my decision was, once you want to spend the rest of your life with someone, you want the rest of your life to begin as soon as possible, right? And so it did a week later. And in our wedding picture, Dad's not there because he was selling duck calls, because one week to the next, he didn't have a chance to change it. And he didn't want to be there anyway, so you already know that. And I had the only beard in the picture, just so you know. As to how we would turn out.
We celebrated our anniversary, 35 years, on November the 9th. And so I texted his brothers.
Yep.
I texted his brothers and just said, thank you for loving me for 35 years.
So let's move it forward, though. You get married, good thing. And then a few months later, you're pregnant. Is that right, Lisa?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What were those emotions like? Mm-hmm. Your knight in shining armor. I mean, all this stuff. It's now, is it falling into place or do you have worries?
Well, no. You know, at first, I thought, when we first got married, I thought, this is going to be perfect. Because it doesn't matter about all the rest of the stuff that has happened to us. We're together now. That's all that matters. You know, all the baggage that we had, we just put that up underneath the bed and in the closet. And, you know, I really thought that this was going to be the best thing since sliced bread. But, and it was for a little while, you know, until the newness wears off. It's always the best thing right at first.
Oh, sure.
And so then I get pregnant, and we're excited about that. I was 20 when I had my baby, so that made Alan 21. But she was a preemie baby, and she weighed 1 pound and 15 ounces. And
wow.
She
about
was
12 inches long.
12 inches long, and at a month old, she had to have heart surgery because she had a heart murmur. And so, what I really thought during this time was that, this is my payback. This is what's happening. God's punishing me for what I did when I was 16. And anyway, Anna did great. She was in the hospital for 3.5 months, but came home on Father's Day, 1986, and she was just perfect. So then when I'm 21, I get pregnant again, and I have my daughter, Alex, but whenever I was about, I don't know, probably six months into the pregnancy, I started having problems with her too. And so I thought, here it goes again. God's punished me again because, you know, I killed a child whenever I was 16. This is just my punishment. But I carried her to term. She was fine. Got pregnant again in 1988. I was 22.
Right.
And I miscarried that baby. Hmm. And, finally I just said, okay, it's time to stop. Because I thought, if God's going to keep punishing me with all these pregnancies, I don't want my babies to suffer.
Yeah. Al, can I ask a question? You're a pastor. That connection, some would say, well, that's consequence.
Right.
Some might say that.
Right.
How do you think theologically we should, as healthy Christians, measure that and live through those circumstances when you've done something that is against God's wishes and then there are circumstances mm-hmm. that seem punitive?
Right.
What's a more godly way to look at this?
Well, I think, and sometimes women do have problems from abortion. that do affect them physically on future pregnancies. So, you know, you got that dealing there as well. But I think when you look at it, it's which lens you look through. If you look through a spiritual lens, you realize that God created us because he loves us. And he created us to have an eternal relationship with him. And so no matter what has been done on planet Earth, when we repent and we look to him and say, we want to accept your forgiveness and your love, we have an eternal relationship with him from that point forward. And so I think as things happen to us, of course, we may relate them to some decision or some other thing, but in the eternal sense of how God operates, he only leads us in love. That's all he's ever wanted, is to love us. And so what Lisa's thinking at that time was out of her own guilt and shame. What she didn't realize was that if she would be able to give that guilt and shame to him, he would be able to comfort her in ways she just never even imagined. And she wasn't feeling that comfort at all.
Yeah.
Because she hadn't given that to him.
And it's kind of like, it's almost like we're boxed in our own thinking.
That's
because
right.
On the one side, we want to believe in unconditional love.
Right. Mm.
But then we beat ourselves up that there's a conditional forgiveness.
That's right. And so that's how we put back towards God our human feeling of what this feels like to me. And God only comes back and says, if you'll just lay that down, if you'll put that at the foot of the cross of Jesus Christ, I can remove all that, which Lisa finally did. It took her a few more years to get to that point. When she did, she sees it totally different now, which is why she can talk to audiences about how Christ has removed the guilt and shame.
Well, that is the truth. Lisa, in that regard, when you're trying to struggle through forgiving yourself and you can't because you've done something so terrible that you don't see how God can forgive you, what are those things that a woman can do today? She did have an abortion 10, 15, 20 years ago, 2 weeks ago. What can she think through to say, okay, Lord, I heard this program, I heard Lisa today, please help me. What can she do?
Well, I think the first thing that we have to realize is that God made us. God is the one that put the child within our body. And God should be the only one to take that. But at the same time, he loves us unconditionally. And he never wants us to feel as though something that we've done is going to be a retroactive, you know, like, yeah. Oh, he's going back to this and he's going to punish me because I did this. The first thing that I would tell somebody to do is to just realize that God loves you beyond anything you can ever ask or imagine.
Yes.
The second thing is, whenever he sent his son to the cross, he sent his son to the cross for every sin, not just one small little white lie, not just, you know, somebody stole something. He sent his son to the cross for women who have had abortions. He sent his son to the cross for men who have, you know, messed with other men's wives. He sent his son to the cross for every despicable sin that we can think of. So whenever I look at the cross and I look at that blood that drained down that cross, if I cannot forgive myself, what I'm saying is that's not enough. But it has to be enough.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Because he was sinless. And he was sent to the cross. His blood is enough to cover our sin.
Well, you have said it well.
And we say that in the book. The only way you're ever able to forgive yourself is to fully embrace the forgiveness of God. Mm-hmm. That's what gives you the capacity. Because we're harder on ourselves most of the time than anyone. But God says, I love you that much. So if I'm able to embrace his forgiveness, I can even look at my own life and say, that's gone. You took it. Mm-hmm. It's over. We're not going to be bound by that anymore. And that's what happened with us.
Now, I so appreciate that boldness and that punch that you had in desperate forgiveness. You mentioned the five-way forgiveness, and I'll just read them quickly because we're at the end.
Okay.
Forgiveness from God, forgiveness from the one who offended you, forgiveness from the family of God, the church, Let me ask you to comment there.
Oh, wow. Sometimes that's the hardest one, is because the place we need and want to go becomes sometimes a deterrent. When Lisa came forward at our church and wrote a letter that she had been involved in an affair, which is another part of our story, and was just finally so shattered and broken, you'll never know what that did for me. Because I knew then that she had stepped over sometimes the biggest obstacle, and that was to go to the people of God and say, I'm a wreck and I need help. She was a hero that day. And at the time I didn't see it, but later I look back and say, that's what we have to have inside the church, is people being willing to tell and let other people know about the victories of God.
The last two are forgiveness extended to the one who offended you, and finally forgiveness extended to yourself.
Right.
Those are the five key things to forgiveness. Mm-hmm. Let me transition just at the end to the New York event, which we held last year. Both of you were there. Thank you for coming. What were your observations of what you saw?
Well, you know, like you described beautifully earlier here to this crowd, you know, it was a little frightening and intimidating at first, because you come in, it's in Times Square. But, you know, when we got inside the ropes, so to speak, of, you know, the people that were there, and people were singing and praising God, and the people you mentioned were speaking, and just right to my heart, too. It was inspiring. I mean, Lisa and I were in tears. We were so glad we were there, and so glad that Focus stepped out and you know, took the lead. It was awesome.
Well, I hope you can join us May 9th coming
up.
Oh,
absolutely.
In one of those five cities.
Absolutely.
And, you can be with us. We'd love to have you with us.
We brought our granddaughter.
I remember
to New
she
York.
Was with us. Yeah.
And I think that's important for us. We've got to talk to our grandchildren, those of us who have them, and we've got to let them know that our love for them is unconditional also. If you get pregnant, I'm still going to love you as much as I did before you told me that.
Yeah. And our 13-year-old granddaughter needed to hear that heartbeat.
That's right.
You know, she needed to know.
It's one of the best things a young lady can hear. That's for sure.
We encourage it, for sure.
Al, one of the things I've never found is a testimony like this, and it's setting up for the last question about the pro-life movement being pro-love. I've never heard a person give me a testimony where it goes like this. Those Christians were so harsh toward me. They were so mean toward me. I decided to become one of them. It's just not a testimony that you hear.
That's right.
I haven't yet.
No.
What I hear is, I was so vile toward these Christians, and they responded in such kindness, it confounded me.
Right.
And that's what led me to Christ. Speak about that idea that the pro-life movement needs to be pro-love.
You know, that we say that often, is that pregnancy centers, which is who we primarily work with, but other organizations as well, are really putting pro-life, you know, pro-love into the pro-life movement. But it really what it is we're presenting, instead of the Pharisee of the Gospels, which is exactly what you described, we're presenting Christ. And that is, hurl your insults, heap on your criticism, but we're going to love you anyway. And that's what I see over and over and over again. And we dropped our signs, because we were big protesters 30 or 40 years ago. And look, I did it too in conscience. I thought I was doing the right thing. I dropped my sign, and I started going over and talking to young women and young men that are in trouble. And so when they can walk in your doors, these places are frontline ministry. A lot of these people would never enter my church, but they're going to walk into that pregnancy center. So a counselor there or someone there is going to be able to show them Christ and not the Pharisees.
Wow. Al and Lisa, you have been so vulnerable tonight, and I love the way God has woven your story together. That little girl's sixth grade heart, you found your knight in shining armor.
I did.
And Al.
And he's still here.
Al, it just took you a few years to figure it out. So let's give him a hand, Atlanta.
Thank you.
Well, that night in Atlanta, Georgia, with Al and Lisa Robertson was just electrifying, and we loved taking Focus on the Family on the road to share these strong pro-life messages with our listeners.
And we did, and we won't soon forget the folks that joined us in those five cities. Mm-hmm. One of my favorite moments in Atlanta happened after we recorded the program. Out in the lobby of Mount Perrin Church, I saw Lisa praying with a woman who was in tears, mm-hmm. and you can sense healing was happening right there in the lobby. It was powerful, and I'm so excited to see what's going to happen with our Alive 2020 event to bring even more healing across this land.
And we've talked about this before. Coming up on May 9th, just a couple of months away, is a five-city simulcast, Jim. It's a big deal.
Well, we'll be returning to the five areas, Southern California, Dallas, South Florida, Chicago, and Atlanta, to stand for life, just as we did with our Alive from New York event last year. We'll have some amazing speakers and recording artists, and of course, a live 4D ultrasound of a baby broadcast in each of those five locations on massive digital screens. It's going to be great, and you don't want to miss it. Come out and be a part of this. Stand for those who don't have a voice. Let me also say, if Al and Lisa's story has touched your heart, or maybe even stirred up some emotions for you, or bad memories, we're here for you at Focus on the Family. We have caring Christian counselors who would count it a privilege to talk with you and pray with you.
It would be a privilege for us to do that, and we're a phone call away. We also have a number of outstanding resources, and of course, Al and Lisa's book is one of them, Desperate Forgiveness. It chronicles their journey to forgiveness. It'd be a privilege for us to send that to you. Stand with us as we proclaim the value of human life by your donation here to Focus on the Family. Through our Option Ultrasound program, Jim, we're estimating 459,000 babies have been saved through that program.
No, it's great. It's awesome.
And we want to invite you to be part of that. You have a chance to help thousands more when you make a monthly pledge of $60 to support Option Ultrasound. Gene and Jim do that. Dina and I support the ministry on a monthly basis. We'd love for you to do that as well. Join us and help us save babies. And when you do, we'll say thank you for that monthly pledge by sending a copy of the book by Al and Lisa Robertson, Desperate Forgiveness. Our number, if you'd like to donate or reach out for help, is 800-A-IN-THE-WORD-FAMILY, 800-232-6459, or click the link below. On behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for joining us. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back next time as we once again help you and your family thrive in Christ.